stay a while and listen. In this episode of Creative Shrimp Podcast, we're going to be talking about many different things, mostly about Diablo 2 Remaster, but actually no, about computer graphics, obviously, about our projects that are currently in works. The highlight of this particular episode of Shrimp Vision will be the procedural course. I will show some exciting screenshots and maybe some video, and I will definitely talk about it a bit more. But for now, let's talk about some other also super exciting things.
Coffee. Presentations in 3D. Started with a blimp. It's Creative Shrimp.
So first of all, I'd like to invite you to watch the Eevee Demos collection that is posted on the Creative Shrimp channel. The speed and enthusiasm at which Blender developers are adding new features to both Eevee and Cycles is truly impressive. Each new video like that, so the compilation of Eevee Demos, is more and more remarkable than the last one, even though the last one was already pretty much super close to what we may expect from render engines, like rather from game engines even, like Unreal 4. The graphics quality at the first glance is quite comparable, especially if we don't take the real-time aspect into account, because obviously Eevee is semi-real-time render engine, not super optimized, that isn't supposed to run in 60 frames per second frame rate as opposed to, say, Unity or Unreal. But with the features like Screen Space Global Illumination or SSGI, you can download the SSGI plugin, by the way, by following the link in the description. It will lead you to the Gumroad page. Just download it. It's free to pay, so you can technically download it for free, or you can donate a little bit to help the developer of this plugin to keep the development going. Obviously, SSGI has a bunch of limitations. It depends on the angle of the camera in relationship to the light source and so on and so forth. But it's quite impressive. I'm sure you have seen this corridor demo that we have created by utilizing our photo scans of the Bernardine Cloister in Brest. And we added the SSGI lighting on top of that. And voila! It's pretty much like real-time ray tracing kind of stuff. It looks totally plausible. But you know what? Cycles strikes back as well. A few days ago, Cycles X was announced. It's a new version of Cycles that is currently being developed by amazing Blender developers. Oh, how I love them. Oh, how I love you, Blender devs. And the main thing about Cycles X is the new architecture of path tracing, much more optimized than before. It was rebuilt from scratch, and it's much speedier. It's comparable to the speed boost of eCycles, something along these lines. I have tested it, but I can say right away that it's like 2 times faster, easily. In some cases less, in some cases more. The more complicated is the scene, the speedier it gets in Cycles X, the more room for optimization there is. Some features are still missing, obviously, because that's a development build. The volume shaders, for example, and some other features, I believe. But most of the Blender demos, like the schoolroom demo, the BMW demo, and so on, the barbershop, I believe, can be opened without a hitch. And once again, the speed boost is remarkable, especially with using the real-time denoising, which is either denoising by Intel OpenImage denoiser or OptiX denoising, which uses the NVIDIA GPUs. It's truly remarkable, actually. It's close to real-time in some cases, if your scene is not overloaded with stuff. Plus, you throw the adaptive sampling into the mix and the approximate ambient occlusion bounces. I think it's called approximate GUI bounces, global illumination bounces, something like that. Actually, from my experience, I can tell that if, for example, the shader is super complex, if your node graph looks like spaghetti monster, Cycles can be even speedier than Eevee. Eevee borrows some ray tracing approaches from Cycles. Cycles aims to perform like Eevee. Both these render engines eventually will converge into some kind of game-like real-time solution that's inevitable. But don't drop Cycles yet. It will surprise you.
But if you want to learn more about truly optimized Cycles rendering settings, no matter the Cycles version, check the Derek Barker's Twitter and YouTube. For example, Derek managed to render this classroom scene in just 1 second and a half by using original Cycles, not even Cycles X. How? Check Derek's Twitter.
Alright, have you watched the Rachel's course? Creating sci-fi icospheres in Blender using HardOps. It's a no-brainer if you wanted to learn more about HardOps or try it for the first time, even because it's a beginner-level tutorial aimed at get you up and running with HardOps. I'm so proud and happy to see the feedback, the countless icospheres popping up here and there within the Twitterverse of Blender. The one by Sean Kennedy is amazing, I think. It's a fully fledged concept art, and I'm even tempted to maybe put together a separate video with some kind of a compilation of the icospheres, because it's amazing. It's amazing. That's the kind of feedback that makes us want to create more. That's the best feedback that means that it's actually useful. For me, it's one of the best feelings ever. To know that we do what we do and you get something useful out of it. That's a win-win situation. That's what everyone should be aiming for, the mutual benefit, I guess. So yeah, if you have followed along the Rachel's tutorial and created the sci-fi icosphere in your own style, or just followed through the steps and arrived at very similar result, please send it to us. We love seeing feedback like this. The other Creative Shrimp project that has just been released is obviously creating stylized 3D art in Blender, feat Manu Järvinen. It's about principles and techniques of creating non-photorealistic art that you can implement in Blender and I believe in other software, but it's obviously aimed at the Blender users that want to dive deeper into the world of NPR, of Blender NPR specifically. Within the Creative Shrimp Lab, we're brainstorming different ideas and opportunities to maybe put together some update for it. That's why I wanted to ask you to break the monologic nature of the podcast and maybe bring in some interactivity into it. I wanted to ask you, maybe you have already enrolled in the course, so I'm deeply interested to learn more about how you feel about it. What aspects of the course did you enjoy and what made you a little bit uncomfortable and whatever? And most importantly, what would you want to see in the update? What feature is missing and you would want us to fill that gap? Please don't hesitate to leave your comment below this video and tell us what would you like to see in the update to creating stylized 3D art series. Okay, what else? Yet another sub-universe in the Shrimp multiverse is the photo scanning project that is brewing within our labs. It's the project that we're making with the help of Eugenii Palamarchuk from Belarus amidst the biggest political crisis in Belarus. 30,000 people detained. The biggest political crisis, I tell you, it's insane. And still we are making these photo scanning projects. It's even more fun because we are using drone to snap some photos. Come on! It's even more fun because we are using drone to capture our footage alongside the other methods, like classical photo scanning by utilizing DSLR cameras and stuff like that. I think we need to record some kind of a documentary because that's truly an interesting experience. So the latest development in our photo scanning is that we started to use Color Checker, better late than never, for calibrating the camera profile. We also incorporated Darktable. Darktable is the open source version of Lightroom, I guess. The differences are that Darktable is more, how should I put it, scene referred, while Lightroom is a little bit more display referred. We also tested Meshroom extensively. It's the open source solution for photogrammetry. But the latest developments in this field is that Epic Games, who also make Unreal Engine, obviously they bought Reality Capture, which is probably, well, one of the best software for photo scanning, which is insanely fast, which produces great geometries, and now it costs a lot less. Actually, it's something like 4 times less for some of the licenses, and you can use it for the preview purposes for free. So it's also a very interesting development that may or may not, but I would say that it will affect how we approach the photo scanning course. So now let me present the highlight of this show.
Procedural texturing in Blender, masterclass by Luca Rude.
By procedural texturing, I mean the node-based macaroni monster designs in Blender that produce magical results, like Nodevember shaders, if you know what Nodevember is, and you sure know what it is. Materials, have you heard about that as well? This hashtag, taming the complexity, the seeming complexity or the real complexity of node-based trees of materials in Blender, and learning ins and outs of procedural texturing and procedural shading and just nodes in general. Inputs, outputs, mathematical operations, how nodes connect to other nodes and into building blocks and into elaborate groups to produce stunning, stunning shaders. It starts very basic and gradually moves into the territory of more complex setups. And in the end, you create this kind of a complex looking shader that consists of multiple layers interacting with each other, that is totally PBR, physically based, in terms that it consists of the albedo color, roughness, displacement, and all the jazz that combined produces beautiful shaders. If my cat won't be interrupting me. Luca is an amazing instructor and tutor, and I personally can't wait to show you more.
Hi, I'm Luca Rode, and in this course I'll be taking you through the process of building a complex procedural shader from beginning to end while exploring the techniques and thought process behind every step. We'll be making a rustic and weathered brick wall. But the main objective is not just to build the shader itself, but rather to explore and understand the underlying techniques. We'll look at everything from the basic theory behind rendering and the use of the node editor, all the way to the creation of an actual complete shader. And by the end of the course, you'll be ready to make your own detailed procedural materials.
Thanks so much for watching. As usual, feel free to leave your comments below this video. Feel free to share and subscribe. I can't wait to share the fruits of our labor with you, and hopefully you will enjoy it as much as we do producing it. My name is Gleb Alexandrov. You are watching the Creative Shrimp podcast. Feel free to send the letter to political prisoners in Belarus, because there are more than 300 political prisoners. And actually, there are many more ways to support the civic society in Belarus. I will tell you more about it later on. Drink more coffee, and we will change the world of computer graphics. I will still play Diablo 2, I think. It was one of my favorites. Roguelike, action, roguelike, or how do you call it? Slasher games. which hasn't been topped by anything yet. Not even close. One of the best games ever. And the music and the general satanic vibe. Oh, the wrong chord. No. And everything about it was beautifully done. Also a beautiful chord.